Okay, all right. Good evening, everyone. Let's call together our Lynnwood City Council business meeting for this evening, Monday, October 24th, 2016. Already the end of October almost. So let's see, who's doing this? Council member Sessions, would you please lead us in the flag salute?
My pleasure.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation,
under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And Council Assistant, can we have the roll call, please?
Yes.
Mayor Smith?
I am here.
Council President Boyer?
Here.
Council Vice President Goodwin? Councilmember Cotton?
Present.
Councilmember Ross?
Here.
Councilmember Sessions?
Here.
Councilmember Hurst?
Present.
Councilmember Sutton?
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on to item 30, our approval of minutes. Councilmember Hurst?
Yes.
Will you do the honors?
I would be delighted. So I have for approval the minutes of a business meeting, October 10th, 2016, and a work session for October 17th, 2016. Does anybody want to make any amendments to these before?
How about a second?
Second.
Okay.
Second. Thank you.
Now do you want to do anything?
Yes, Councilmember Cotton.
I did notice that on page 30-A-8, on line 18, when we were talking about the town hall, I think I had mentioned that CM Sutton, Councilmember Sutton, had originally brought this topic up. So I just wanted to amend that line 18 to add right before the period, say, and mentioned he believed that CM Sutton had originally brought this topic up.
Anything else? All right. All those in favor of approving the minutes, please say aye.
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 Any opposition? So moved. I'm going to defer my messages to the item 60 with our proclamation. So let's start with 50 here, citizen comments. So I will call citizens up as they have signed in on the sheet. You will be able to address council as a whole for 3 minutes. And the first one on the list is Steve LaFond. Welcome. If you come to the podium, please state your name and address.
Hi, my name is Steve LaFond. 19725 76th Avenue West, Lynnwood. I'm here tonight representing the History and Heritage Board. And as you may know, we made a lot of progress over the last year developing into a more inclusive and integrated board and creating a heritage plan to help guide our work over the next several years. And now it's time to implement that plan. And to that end, we have requested $10,000 in 2017 and 2018 to implement projects in support of our mission, connecting community members with the city of Lynnwood to help build a positive sense of place. And some of those projects include installation of interurban trail interpretive signs and markers, expansion of history and heritage exhibits for city buildings and events, development and promotion of heritage park events and programs, the scanning, cataloging, and displaying of historic photographs in city buildings and on the city website, and supporting the traffic signal box project with history and heritage-related wrappings. I appreciate your time, your consideration, and your support. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Next on the list is Ted Heichel.
Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place Southwest in Lynnwood. I know you have a long meeting tonight, so I'll be very brief. When I was a young high school student, I was very fortunate one summer to be able to go visit my uncle and aunt who lived in New Jersey just across the river from New York City. And one of the great trips that I took into the city included a visit to the United Nations. I was so inspired by that went back to our high school in Dayton, Ohio. And a good friend of mine and I started the Junior Council on World Affairs, which I'm very happy to tell you, more than 60 years later, is still active at Chaminade High School in Dayton. October 24th is United Nations Day. It's been a very important institution in our country and in the world. And I just want to take this moment to ask all of you to take a moment to think about the United Nations and United Nations Day every October 24th. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others who'd like to make comments this evening? All right, we'll move on to 60. We do have a proclamation tonight, and I just wanted to introduce that as you, if you would like to, as you, Councilmember Ross, makes her way to the podium. So Veterans Day is quickly approaching, and I would just like to take this opportunity to share with you the efforts that we have done to try to make Lynnwood a veteran-supportive city. So our one-stop Veterans Resource Center is located at the Verdant Wellness Center. It continues to serve veterans and their families with a wide variety of services. This past summer, through a collaboration with the Lynnwood Rotary, we were able to help furnish Sebastian Place. It's an apartment complex for homeless veterans that recently opened just right on almost the border of our city, right at the top of 196, and it's housing 20 homeless veterans. We have a committee that's working diligently to open the Northwest Veterans Museum, which will be housed at our Heritage Park, and we anticipate that museum to open early next year. On Wednesday, November 2nd at 10:30, in partnership with Evans Community College and the Korean Consulate, we'll be paying tribute and honor to our Korean War veterans. And I'd like to invite you to join us at the Black Box Theater on Edmonds Community College campus for this celebration. We continue to support our local VFW Post 1040 during their annual Memorial Day and Veterans Day events. So please join us on Veterans Day Friday, November 11th at 11 a.m. at our Veterans Park as we pay tribute to the men and women who have served and are currently serving in our armed forces. And tonight, we will be reading and adopting a proclamation to honor Veterans Day. This evening, we welcome members from our local veterans of Foreign War Post 1040. The post commander, John Beam, is a longtime city employee, and he works down at our wastewater treatment plant. And I'd like to ask Commander Beam and other members of Post 1040 to join Councilmember Ross at the podium as she reads the proclamation.
Good evening. Proclamation, City of Lynnwood, Veterans Day. Whereas the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918 marked the end of the war to end all wars and the cessation of the most destructive and far-reaching war in human history. And whereas it is well deserving that the anniversary of this date, Armistice Day, should be commemorated with thanksgiving and ceremonies designed to perpetuate peace through goodwill and mutual understanding between nations. And whereas on June 1st, 1954, Congress declared that Armistice Day should become Veterans Day to honor all who had served in all wars to preserve world peace. And on October 8th, 1954, President Eisenhower issued the first Veterans Day proclamation. And whereas the men and women of our armed forces protect our nation with honor, courage, and valor, they serve during times of conflict and times of peace to protect our nation's founding principles of freedom, justice, and liberty for all. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, Mayor Nicholas Smith and the Lynnwood City Council, proclaim November 11, 2016 as Veterans Day. And we urge all people of Lynnwood to recognize the valor and sacrifice of our nation's veterans and join us as we strive to create a veterans-supportive city. And I would move the council concur in this proclamation.
Second.
And all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
John.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to pick this up from the council. If you look back, you will find that Post 1040 of Lynnwood predates the city of Lynnwood by 20 years. The post was formed in 1939 in what was called then Seattle Heights, which is over off 66th, 204th. Ultimately, it became Lynnwood in 59, and we're proud to help the city with the veterans programs and everything we can do.
Keep in mind, on the 5th of November, which is a Saturday before Veterans Day, we're going to have a cleanup at the park.
Good. So, thank you. Good.
In order to be ready for our program on the 11th, which I will be the chairman of. So thank you very much, Mayor and Council.
Thank you. You would come forward to our dais here, and we'll get a photo. Perfect.
Okay, hold it for me. 1, 2, 3. Couple more. And one more good one. Big cheese. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Good to see you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Good to see you.
Thanks, John. Good to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Sure.
Thank you, sir, for being
good to meet you. It's a long ways from the wastewater plant to the council.
You don't come nearly often.
I'm in a hurry tonight.
I guess I will share one more mayor message. Thank you, Mr. Heichel, for reminding us about United Nations Day. It happened at my house on Saturday. My parents started hosting international students from the University of Washington back in 1982, and the first one arrived when I was living in Denmark for a year. And I got this letter, and it said, "Dear Nicola, I am now your new big brother. I'm staying in your room. I'm from Nigeria." And then I got another letter. "Dear Nicola, this is Inji. I'm from Turkey. I'm staying in your room, and I am now your next big sister." And Inji came from Turkey to visit us this last week. She hadn't been here in 35 years.
Oh, wow.
And at my table, we had 18 people from those days at the University of Washington who many of us had not seen each other in 35 years. And we had Nigeria and France and the Philippines and Israel and Turkey and Belgium and the United States and several others. And it was just a real heartwarming people-to-people relationship building. And time flies. 35 years later, and we all felt like, you haven't aged a bit. Well, kind of. But anyway, it was a really, really neat experience on Saturday. All right, with that, are there any written communications or petitions that I don't know about? Thank you. We'll move on to item 80. This is council comments, and we'll be starting with Vice President Goodwin. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me. There are two announcements that I wanted to make. One is the Lynnwood Police Department Citizens Academy is starting again on January 12th. It's a 14-week program every Thursday at 7 p.m. So I would encourage you, if you have not been able to participate, do so. It's a fantastic experience, a fantastic way to learn about what the police department does in our city. There are a lot of different activities. You hear from each sub-department, I guess you could call them, of the police department, from the patrol to SWAT to all the different groups, and it's a fantastic event. So I'd encourage you to give that a try and just go and see what our police department is all about. It's a good, and especially good way to hear from them directly and get the information straight from the source. So please do sign up for that. And also, just a reminder that ballots have gone in the mail, and everyone should have received them. And you should have one, so use it. Do your homework and go out and vote. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Sessions.
Thank you. I wanted to invite the public to a trunk and treat, an alternative to trick-or-treating, at the Alderwood Community Church on Monday, October 31st from 6 to 8:30. It's a free event open to the public and safe and fun and lots of things to do for all ages. So come on out.
Councilmember Hurst.
Thank you. Just briefly, it's interesting about United Nations Day. There's a couple things I remember. When I grew up in New York, and it was really big to do trick-or-treat for UNICEF, where we would we had milk cartons then. We would wrap milk cartons with a UNICEF label and go out and get funds for UNICEF. And those were good memories. But interesting about the UN, this weekend we went to the Aldwood Mall to look at, there was a Lego American Foundation's display of all kinds of elaborate construction by Legos of landmarks in American history. And it was fascinating, the numerous languages that I heard in the Aldwood Mall as people went around and saw all these landmarks. It just, in fact, I mentioned to my wife, I said, this is like being in the UN. And so it's just serendipity that today is UN Day. But thank you.
Councilmember Sutton?
I also would like to ask, no matter who you want to vote for, just make sure you vote, because that's one of the reasons why we're here and can exercise our democratic system. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. First off, just a, from the public service announcement and communication, today we met the RFA subcommittee, met for the first time today. So if you're an interested citizen in knowing what's going on with that, there is a website that's up and running, and it will be periodically updated. And so it is www.linwoodfd1rfa.com. So that's linwoodfd1rfa.com. And that's a great place to find information. Meeting minutes will be posted. Meeting times and places will be posted. So it's a great location to be informed on the process and know what's going on. So, and then the second thing is I will just echo the sentiments of others up here. Please vote. So, vote. Thank you.
Perfect.
Please.
Echo.
I implore you. Thank you.
Councilmember Ross.
Well, I wish everybody would vote too. I got my ballot today, and I've already put it in the box. So,
wow.
I knew what I was doing. All right. I also wanted to mention the Legos. It really is very interesting. It's there till the 30th at the mall, and they are just so impressive, massive structures of historical buildings. The Capitol building's there, the Washington Monument's there, the Statue of Liberty's there. My granddaughter was absolutely enthralled with the whole thing. So it's worth seeing and before they take it all down and haul it all away. Really good opportunity to talk about American history with young children. My granddaughter is almost six, and she was absolutely fascinated by the whole thing. So it was a great opportunity. Don't forget, kids are going to be out Halloween next Monday. We'll be here, unfortunately not in costume. Maybe. But be careful. It's getting dark earlier and earlier, and the little ones are going to be out. So everybody be careful.
Thank you. And President Boyer?
Thank you, Your Honor, and thank you to my colleagues for bringing up these important things. Yes, please vote. I have an official announcement tonight. A question has been raised as to whether Councilmember Sessions may vote on the ordinance that will adopt the city's budget for the 2017-2018 biennium, or whether Councilmember Sessions has a conflict of interest that will prevent her from voting on the budget ordinance based on her spouse's position as a firefighter in Lynnwood Fire Department. After carefully considering this matter, the city's position is that Councilmember Sessions may vote on the budget ordinance. We have several reasons for that. For one, the potential compensation of city fire department personnel is set by the city's contract with the Fire Personnel Union, IAFF Local 1984. Councilmember Sessions recused herself from participating in any and all discussions on that union contract. Importantly, she recused herself from the vote on the union contract, and the budget will simply incorporate the compensation amounts already established in that contract. Secondly, the City Council has no authority over the hiring, supervision, or promotion of city staff. That's within the authority of the administration and, in the case of the fire department, the city's Civil Service Commission. Finally, the city will adopt the city staff position and salary schedule by an ordinance that is separate from the budget ordinance, and Councilmember Sessions does intend to recuse herself from voting on that ordinance to avoid any appearance of conflict of interest. And I will add that she will be recusing herself later this evening as we discuss the fire department's budget, again, to avoid any appearance of conflict of interest. So that is that's the news from that quarter. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, let's move on to 90.1, our unanimous consent agenda. And Councilmember Cotton, would you please do the honors?
I will. First of all, would any council member like to remove any item from the consent agenda? Hearing no one, I move to adopt the following consent agenda items. A, contract award, biosolid hauling. Authorize the mayor to execute a contract with Vanderveen Family Transport for the hauling of biosolids to the City of Edmonds and the King County Renton Treatment Plant during periods when the incinerator is not functioning through December 31st, 2016 for an estimated cost of $200,000 inclusive of sales tax. B, contract award court processing software. Authorize the mayor to execute a contract with O-Court for implementation and annual maintenance for court processing and integration software for up to 5 years. Estimated at $66,500, including implementation, inclusive of sales tax. C, contract amendment, prosecuting attorney services. Authorize the mayor to execute a contract amendment to extend prosecuting attorney services with Zachary and Thomas at an estimated annual value of $528,000. D, lease use agreement, Snow Isle Genealogical Society and City of Lynnwood, Humble House at Heritage Park. Authorize mayor to enter into Humble House lease use agreement between the City of Lynnwood and the Snow Isle Genealogical Society. E, amendment to interlocal agreement with Snohomish County Fire District No. 1 for City Fleet Services. Authorize the mayor to enter into, on behalf of the city, an amendment to the interlocal agreement between the City of Lynnwood and Snohomish County Fire District No. 1 for city-supplied fleet mechanical services dated June 23, 2015 to be in effect January 1, 2016 through December 31, 2018. F, voucher approval. Approve claims and payroll in the amount of $3,279,619.43 and $1,265,812.12 respectively.
Thank you. Our consent agenda will be approved as read. We have a public hearing tonight, 90.2. This is with regard to our capital facilities plan 2017 to 2022. All persons wishing to be heard at this public hearing should sign up on the sign-up sheet. Any person who does not sign up on the sheet shall speak after all those who have signed up, and you will be given 3 minutes to give your testimony. The public hearing for Capital Facilities Plan 2017-2022 is now open. This is a public hearing on a legislative action. Legislative actions include the adoption, amendment, or revision of comprehensive community or neighborhood plans or other land use planning documents, or adoption of zoning ordinances or amendments which are of area-wide significance. The purpose of this hearing is for City Council to hear testimony and take action relating to the Capital Facility Plans 2017-2022. This public hearing must be fair and free of conflict of interest. Therefore, I would like to ask, and this applies to myself as well, does anyone have a conflict of interest on this issue? Councilmember Cotton.
I would just like to point out that I received clarification today that the capital spending plan for 2015-16 was included in the packet, which included a potential conflict item, but we will be discussing an item tonight for 1617, which will not include the item. Is that correct? Okay, great. I just, since this was the opportunity to speak to that, I just wanted to make sure that I was good. And City Attorney, do you concur?
Yes, I concur. That's correct information.
Okay. Thank you very much, all.
Thank you. This is our hearing procedure. Everyone present will be given an opportunity to be heard. An official recording is being made of what is said at this hearing. Therefore, persons addressing the council are requested to begin by stating their name and address. Please speak slowly and clearly into the microphone. Only one person may speak at a time. This is the time for the presentation of testimony, and no debate is allowed. The order of speaking will be as follows. First, our staff presentation to introduce the proposal. Secondly, testimony from the public, either in support of, neutral to, or against the proposal. I may deviate from the order of speakers as they signed in if there's a need for anyone to leave early or has special needs. Thirdly, any testimony from staff in response to the testimony from the public. And last, City Council will then ask questions of anyone who has testified. So before hearing from our audience, I'm going to introduce Jeff Elikish and Bill Franz from our Public Works Department, who will make our staff presentation. Welcome.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Bill Franz, Public Works Director here. Before I turn it over to City Engineer Elikish, I just wanted to make a couple quick statements for the Council. First, contextually, if you'll remember last week, I made a presentation on our capital budget and talked about the capital facilities plan being the kind of universe of projects, anything possibly that could come before us in the next 6 years, not restrained by funding. So in other words, there's not funding for all these projects. It's kind of the laundry list of all projects. Jeff will explain about that a little bit more, but I just wanted to remind you of that conversation for context. And secondly, Councilmember Cotton was correct. We discovered that we had made an error when we put the council packet together, and with three of us working together to put the items on the agenda, 90.2A, the last year's ordinance and capital spending plan was inadvertently attached to that item. So I'm going to ask you to ignore 90.2A and look at 90.3A, because on that item we got the correct ordinance attached. And so if you'll refer to that, and then also when it comes time approval, assuming you're going to approve it, please again put your attention to 90.3A, and we do apologize for any confusion that caused. So with that.
Thank you, Bill. Capital Facilities Plan, I'm just going to touch on a couple points. I'm not going to spend a ton of time tonight going over this. We've been through this on many occasions and many fronts. You've seen Capital Facilities Plans in one form or another throughout the year, whether it be the six-year TIP or all the work we did with the utilities and the capital investments that are planned over 6 years as a result of that. But everything that we do in the community or use in the community collectively are elements of the capital facilities plan. These are our water systems, our sewer systems, storm drainage systems, all of the roads. When we talk about infrastructure, it's all of those things that the community uses in one form or another to get from point A to point B, or to maintain and improve their health and welfare, either individually in their homes or collectively when we come together, for instance, at the parks facilities or at the swimming pool, things like that. Moving on, the six-year CFP is mandated by state law under 1990, the Growth Management Act was adopted to require cities to plan for growth. And so we adopt a comprehensive plan, which has many updates periodically. This is one element of that annually that we do an update. The time period is for 6 years, and so we're looking at 2017 to 2022 as the time window or the horizon. Within the list of projects, and if you went and looked at the big binder in one form or another or electronically, it's getting thicker and thicker every year, it seems like. But I can tell you that there are listed over $281 million worth of capital needs that our community has planned for, but that doesn't mean we have all the money for it. So once again, as Bill framed it, this is a capture of the likely things that could occur if funding comes before us, either through grants, partnership opportunities, in the six-year window. These are the projects that come sometimes from our 20-year list down to our six-year list. And then what happens is through the budget process, we adopt a capital budget, and we're doing that the first time this year, as Bill alluded to, which I'm very excited about because we get to consolidate projects finally and streamline some things along that way. So we're progressing in the right direction as it goes on with that. So what you'll find in the document, there's an introduction section. There's a summary of projects that are listed just by project name and dollar amount for the six-year period. Then it's got a great detailed sheet that's usually 2 pages long that'll dive into each project, what it's about, potential funding sources, things like that. That's the detailed level of it. And then for those who need a summary level, and I smile at one of our colleagues on the council, we have a summary at the end that shows each project summarized in a six-year time period. Regardless of where the dollars are shown, what's really important that it's on the list. And regardless of the amounts that are shown, because they may not be correct, sometimes they're the best guess at the time, all of these projects have to come back before the City Council for adoption in one form or another through budgets, contract awards, consultant selection process, all of that stuff we touch upon over and over again through the process. So this just kind of puts a ribbon on it for the next 6 years, so to speak, and we move forward with that. So with that, will you turn it back over to you, Mayor?
Thank you. Are there any written materials to be presented? Is there anyone who would like to make a statement in writing? So at this time, I'll call upon the audience to testify and present any information, starting with those who signed up on the list, and that would be Mr. Ted Heichel.
Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place Southwest in Lynnwood. Thank you, Your Honor and Council. Only two things that I want to bring to your attention. One thing that's on the list and one thing that's not on the list. I found no funding, and this is the second time 2 years ago, you may remember I said the same thing to you. I found no funding for replacing the secure police property facility, which is currently located over in the old Quonset Hut building on the community college site. It was formerly owned by the city, but we sold it to the community college. That room has been languishing there for years now. Our free rent ran out. We're now paying rent for that facility, and I see no plans by the city to replace that building. And I think certainly in the 2017 to 2022 period, let alone in the next 2 years, when the community college is likely to get funding for their new STEM building and will need that property for parking, that facility is going to get torn down. And there's no indication that I see that the city is preparing to replace the secure police property room. I think that's something that absolutely should be on this list. And the other thing that is on the list that I really question is another bunch of money, $150,000 more, to work on the city lobby, city hall lobby, and the council chamber. $150,000, I think, is unnecessary. This room and the lobby is certainly functional and should be able to be used by the citizens and by the council and the administration. And that $150,000, in my opinion, should go into the street fund. Thank you.
Are there others who would like to make comments? Elizabeth Ludensford.
Elizabeth Lunsford, is it zip code or full address now?
Whole address.
Okay. 4025 168th Street, Southwest Lynnwood, Washington.
Thank you.
So I actually came to talk about citizens' comments, but I keep on missing it. They're really hard for anyone to come to. But I was like, if I'm here, I might as well do the public hearing, which I was attending to do. And it's hard to come to. But I want to thank the city that I think it was easy to follow to get the information about the public hearing, the easy click. I think I did 3 clicks on the website, public hearing, saw that the public hearing was here and got the information. So I wanted to give thanks for getting that clear because I had troubles before. But I said the public hearing is difficult, citizens' comments is difficult, but I think you guys are proactive by having the open house earlier this year.
Okay. It's not you.
I think is a more up-to-date, current way to get feedback about what the about the actual capital facility plans are actually going to happen, because it's intimidating looking at the plan. There's feels like hundreds of possibilities, and the likelihood of some and the others is a lot for a person to take care of, but it's obligated to put it out. But having the open house gave a summary of it, so I credit again to the city for making the public open house, and hopefully you can take the feedback that you got from there with today's decision. All right, that's it. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Oh, I wanted to say for the veterans, thank you for making, did I miss that part?
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for doing that, and for the museum, I know. Thank you for the spearheading the museum, Veterans Museum at Heritage Park. There's great movement in the city. All right, that's done. Thank you all.
Thank you. Are there others? Staff, do you wish to respond to any subjects or questions raised by any speaker? Jeff.
The item that was added, or that was that Ted Heichel brought up regarding the $150,000 for City Hall remodeling, really the next phase of that is some of the things that council has asked for. Some of it has to do with security enhancements to this room. Some of it has to do with the audiovisual. As you might know, we always have to look at the screen here, but half of the room can't see the screen. We've talked about widening this out so you guys actually have more leg room and elbow room, and other potential security measures. So whether council wants to leave it in the six-year window or not, I think it's a viable project that could happen, subject to budgeting requirements.
There's ADA requirements.
There are components of ADA, yeah, as well, to the dais access and so forth. So that,
and one other thing, the scope, reviewing a study that we had done on safety, and it includes more than just this building. It's four municipal buildings, looking at a SEPTED type of review on safety, which is just flew out of my head.
Environmental design,
right? It looks at lighting, vegetation, all different aspects of buildings and their surroundings. So that the study we're reviewing right now is four buildings, not just City Hall. So the potential things that could come out of that project are numerous.
And then the other project that was mentioned that should have money that isn't there, there is a project that's called City Building Space Needs Analysis, and that's planned for a couple $100,000 over the six-year period to look at all of our space needs, including evidence. It can be a component of that, even though it's not explicitly called out by itself. I think we can be covered at least for this go-around, but as we dive further into it, we can segregate off special or project-specific things like evidence relocation or replacement down the road.
Actually, a step further, I also was looking through the document as Jeff was talking. There's on page 85, just for your future reference, the police department actually has a building project in here, new justice facility, and this is the description of that. It is to acquire land and construct a new facility that includes an evidence facility. So it actually is included in the plan, but it under the entire new justice facility project.
Council, at this time, you may ask questions of any speaker or staff. Councilmember Sessions?
Just a comment. I just wanted to ditto the same thing, that the $150,000 is really important for those SEPTED reviews and safety and security for the front desk area and here in the City Council chambers has been needed for many, many years. It's always been a concern for me, and I'm very much in favor of keeping that in there. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Staff, so I'm working off the old PDF that was attached, the 90.2, and 90.38 doesn't have that that summarized list. So I'm just prefacing that.
The summarized list you were looking at, there is not one for this version. You were looking at last year's, and
right.
What you're looking at was replaced this year by those six capital budgets we shared with you last week. So
okay.
just to get you oriented.
Okay. So I guess I just had a quick question then. Are we still, I see that we're still carrying the 42nd under City Center projects. We're still carrying the 42nd and the 194th Street. Are those still on the list moving forward?
Yes, they are still active. The 42nd project, we just received a grant for the design phase.
Okay.
And we're negotiating scope and fee and bringing that project forward probably in the first quarter of next year. 194th, the preliminary design or study that we had monies for is coming to conclusion. We hope to report back to you in the first quarter of next year as well as to when and how that project may or may not go forward, given City Center priorities.
Okay. And have we been interfacing closely with the PFD on and the Convention Center? Because I know that project specifically has kind of an impact to that property.
We had during that part of the project where we were taking input.
Okay.
Yes. We'd had numerous conversations.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? All right. Audience, do you have any comments solely to clarify any item raised by a council member's questions? No new issues can be presented, and please. Okay. No new issues can be presented, and please do not repeat your own or any other person's testimony. Your comments should be limited to clarifying any item raised by a council member or staff. Mr. Heichel.
Ted Heichel, 3821 91st Place Southwest. I was happy to hear from Mr. Franz that the Justice Center will include the police property room, but I think in all reality, we're not thinking about building a Justice Center anytime in the next 2 years, and the police property room may be removed from the property by the college before that time, certainly before 2022, and I think that the answer of just saying that, well, there's a Justice Center involved in there is not going to solve the problem. The problem still is there.
Anyone else? All right, there being no further testimony, I will close the public testimony portion of the public hearing. It's now in order for the council to discuss matters and for a council member to make a motion to take action, reopen the public testimony portion of the hearing, or postpone the matter. Council President.
Thank you, Your Honor.
3225.
Move the adoption of City of Lynnwood Ordinance Number 3225, an ordinance adopting the Capital Facilities Plan for the City of Lynnwood for the period 2017 through 2022, and providing for an effective date, severability, and summary publication.
Second.
Any discussion? Would you like to speak to the ordinance?
As always, I want to commend staff for their very thorough work on this capital facilities plan. It's painstaking work quite often, often based on best estimates and best guesses of what kind of grant funding is likely to come in. And I think it's important to remember that although the adoption of the plan does not commit the city to actually moving forward with these projects until such a time as funding is secured, because of the way the grant programs we participate in work, unless a project is on this plan, we can't pursue or can't easily pursue grants for that project. So it's an important step in the process, but it's important to remember where in the process this step falls.
Any other comments? Yeah, Councilmember Cotton.
I would just echo that this is a great body of work done by staff, and I know that, I mean, just looking at the PDF online, it's 215 pages or something, and it's thick, so I appreciate all that work. And I also just want to note, too, that just because we are in budget season, that this is just, as Council President very astutely pointed out, this is just our plan. How we fund it is still, you know, up to dependence on how we go about with the budget and grants and all those other pursuits. So it might seem to some of you out there, well, you know, cart before the horse, but just to clarify that issue, this is our plan, hoping that, you know, having it in the plan allows us to leverage some of that grant application. So.
Thank you. Anything else? We have a roll call, please. Mm-hmm.
Council President Boyer?
Aye.
Councilmember Cotton?
Yes.
Council Vice President Goodwin?
Affirmative.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Seven yes, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3225 passes unanimously. Thank you, gentlemen. We'll move on to 90.3B. This is an ordinance and financial plan, a construction contract award for Meadowdale Neighborhood Park improvements. Council Vice President.
Can I get an ordinance number, please?
3226.
3226. Mm-hmm. Splendid. I move that we, the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, adopt ordinance number 3226, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, superseding ordinance 3184, establishing project funding for design and construction for Meadowdale Neighborhood Park Improvement Project. This ordinance authorizes project expenditures in Fund 322 and funding allocations and transfers from the Fund 330 to Fund 322, and consistent with the project financial plan and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second. Thank you. Would you speak to the ordinance if you want?
Certainly I will. Basically, this deals with the Meadowdale Neighborhood Park improvements, and including this contract will include the additional parking space, access improvements, and a picnic shelter to the existing park amenities. One of the big things about this is it helps to support our city vision of building a healthy and sustained environment and investing in the preservation and expansion of our parks and recreation.
Thank you. Any other comments? You have the roll call, please.
Mm-hmm. Councilmember Cotton?
Affirmative.
Council Vice President Goodwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Aye.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Council President Boyer?
Aye.
Seven yes, Mayor.
Thank you. 3226 passes unanimously. We'll move on to 90. Oh, there's second part. Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
Always keeping tabs on me. Thank goodness.
All right, so I'll go ahead and do that second part then.
Yeah, thanks.
Cool. Please do.
Thank you.
I move that we, the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, authorize the mayor to execute a contract with KA General Construction Contractor, LLC, for $153,308.58, inclusive of sales tax.
Second. Any conversation? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? So moved. Thank you. All right, we're done, right? Okay. Now we'll move on to 90.3C. This is an ordinance financial plan update. Second part is final acceptance of the 212th emergency repair project. And Councilmember Ross, you're willing to take that? Thank you.
Yes, certainly. I would move, let me get to it here. And it is 3227, I assume? I move ordinance number 3227, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, superseding ordinance 3173, establishing funding for the 212th Street Emergency Waterline Repair Project and authorizing expenditures in Fund 411 and consistent with the project financial plan and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
Would you like to speak to the ordinance?
I could. Obviously, this is for an emergency water line repair. It was a 12-inch water main on 212th Street that failed. And obviously, with our infrastructure, we're going to have to fix what fails. So that's what we did and we're doing, and that's what this is for.
Thank you. Any other comments? We'll have a roll call, please. Mm-hmm.
Council Vice President Goodwin?
Yes.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Council President Boyer?
Aye.
Councilmember Cotton?
Yes.
Seven yes, Mayor.
3227 passes unanimously. And would you carry on to part two, please?
I will carry on to part two as soon as I get back to part two here. Okay. I would move the City Council grant final acceptance of the work performed under the contract for the 212th Street Emergency Waterline Repair Project, subject to the requirements of appropriate state and federal agencies, if any, and ultimately release of the retention to the contractor.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? So moved. Thank you. We do not have an executive session, yay, that I'm aware of. So here's the plan. Council, is it too early for your break? Or would you take your break in transition to the work session? All right, so please include your break as you transition to a work session format so that we can discuss the next three departments' budget presentations. And please be ready to go at 8 o'clock. All right, everybody, I'd like to call us back to order. Council has returned to our work session format during our business meeting here. And our audience is so very excited tonight, but we'd really like to invite you to sit down and pay attention. So I would like to move us on to our next budget presentation for council and our community, and welcome Interim Chief Davis and Deputy Chief Nelson to the table to go through their presentation for you. It's about 40 minutes, and you will have about 10 minutes to ask questions. Right? All right. Off you go.
Good evening, members of Council, Mayor Smith, and Lynnwood residents. I want to thank you for the opportunity to present the 2017-18 Lynnwood Police Department proposed budget. I would like to open the presentation by discussing our approach to the budgeting for outcomes process under the direction of the mayor and her executive staff. A primary theme during the BFO process was to convene, converse, and collaborate. That's how we approached the budget process. As we started this process, we sought to analyze each program within the police department to ensure we were doing just that, while also examining how our budget aligned with the city vision and our own department's mission, vision, and values. In late 2015, we convened a team of representatives from the various programs within our police department. The team took a fresh look at what our organizational values were and conversed about how they related to our community vision and what we wanted to accomplish organizationally. This process was a collaborative effort between civilian and commission staff throughout our organization. On the first slide, you will see, let me take a look here just a second, especially organizational values. On the first slide, you will see, the result of our newly formed values, professionalism. It's our first value, committed to professional development while providing ethical, proficient, and respectful service. Vigilance, keeping the community safe through proactive and tenacious pursuit of violators of the law. And community, cultivating positive interactions by fostering trust and partnering with citizens to create a high quality of life. What I want to share with you, and before we move to the next slide, and just keep it where it's at, Jim, is the mission of the Lynnwood Police Department. And I don't want you to look at the words, I just want you to listen to the words, just hear it. The mission of the Lynnwood Police Department is to provide proactive, competent, and effective public safety services to all persons with the highest regard for human dignity through efficient and professional law enforcement and crime prevention practices. That was the result of that collaboration that the organization went through to develop its mission, vision, and values. Thank you. Next slide. On this slide, you'll see our police programs. While most people see the police department as a single entity, it is actually a conglomeration of service groups that work collaboratively to develop and implement solutions to public safety challenges affecting our community. Any challenge may be addressed by two or three programs, where other challenges require the collaborative efforts of different groups of programs. From my initial observations, I can assure you that your police department excels at this internal collaboration. A key focus for this year and the future budget cycle is the intentional, effective, and open collaboration with other city departments, business community, residents, and our visitors to the city of Lynnwood. For the next few minutes, I want to walk you through your police department's programs and provide a brief overview of their functions and outcomes. Patrol. The largest of the police department's programs, the patrol program, consists of 28 police officers, 5 sergeants, and 1 commander. Additional resources include 3 part-time reserve officers and 1 part-time chaplain. Over half of the department's commissioned staff are assigned to this program alone. Within patrol are collateral assignments, such as crime scene technician, canine, field training officers, and drug recognition experts. The reason that these are collateral assignments is because every one of those officers is a patrol officer first. These officers are the face of the department. They provide 24-hour service to our community. Throughout each shift, your patrol officers must wear several hats to address community issues. They must effectively draw upon their training and experience at each call to provide the excellent customer service that we expect from them. Today, more than ever before, their actions are scrutinized, and any misstep or missed opportunity can damage that trust. It ultimately harms the legitimacy of not only themselves, but of your police department. For this reason, we critically screen each applicant, invest heavily in training them properly, and commit resources to ensure that they are properly equipped to meet each challenge with the best chances of positive resolution. Most of our patrol officers have been through the 40-hour crisis intervention course, and many of them have also attended Blue Courage training. Both of these courses are designed for officers to understand their own emotional state and provide them with techniques for de-escalating situations and identifying people who may be suffering from mental health disorders. De-escalation training is interwoven into other scenario-based training and through in-service refresher courses. It is also important to note that each of these 38,540 calls for service is from a person who wants service from the Lynnwood Police Department. To each caller, their issue is important to them and often represents a personally traumatic event or crisis. Each call is therefore an opportunity for the department, and by extension, the city, to offer professional, empathetic, and efficient services to those people that are most affected in our community. The criminal investigations program consists of 1 commander, 1 persons crime sergeant, and 2.5 detectives, 1 property crime sergeant, and 2.5 detectives, and 1 funded vacancy. We're currently carrying a vacancy in investigations division that we hope to fill soon. Caseloads continue to remain high due to staffing levels with a corollary impact on investigative effort. Because of staffing reductions, cases that used to be assigned to detectives, such as misdemeanor property crimes with potential suspects, are no longer assigned for investigation, are instead inactivated if not solved at the patrol level. And I asked earlier, preparing these remarks, what we believe our caseload to be on average, anecdotally. And I think we believe that property crimes detective is carrying about a 40-case caseload, and person crimes detectives are carrying about a 30-case caseload. These are 30 different people, and person crimes are crimes against each other. Obviously, property speaks for itself, property crimes. But each one of those is a story. Each one of those is a victim, a person requesting service. Let me offer you a quick scenario. You look outside your house to see someone breaking into your vehicle and stealing a backpack that contains items of great sentimental value to you, but the actual value is under $750. You see the suspect get into a waiting vehicle and you write down a possible license plate. Patrol officers respond but are not able to locate the suspect and they do take a report. Prior to the recession, your case would have been assigned to a detective to try and link the license plate with the suspect with hope of recovering the property and holding the suspect accountable for their actions. Due to caseloads, this single case is no longer assigned and instead, if not resolved by patrol, would be inactivated. Additional work by investigations includes the services of victim services coordinator who assists victims through the investigative and court-related process while working closely with the investigation staff. And my observation is that the victim services coordinator at the Lynnwood Police Department, the program here is a phenomenal program. The fact that the city has a dedicated staff member assigned to follow up and spend their time and energy with victims is critically important. I mean, oftentimes the criminal justice system can be so complex that victims of crime can oftentimes feel like they're victimized again when by having to tell their story several times over and over and then testifying in court. To have an advocate for them through that process and explain what other services are available has been just outstanding. The South Snohomish County Narcotics Task Force is a multi-agency collaborative effort. Current Lynnwood staffing of the task force includes one-third of a sergeant and two detectives. There's also a Lynnwood detective who is assigned to DEA to coordinate task force investigations with the DEA, as well as to work with the DEA on regional cases that affect our area. The revenue generated from that position funds a patrol officer position and is projected to still be net positive in the future. The reason that that sergeant is one-third of an FTE is because one-third is paid for by Edmonds and the other third is paid for by Mount Lake Terrace. In 2015, the task force seized over 6 kilograms of methamphetamine and over 800 grams of heroin that were destined for our streets here in Lynnwood. Additionally, the task force seized over 46 handguns, including assault rifles that were in possession of drug traffickers. The task force is only one prong of an overall effort to reduce the damaging effects of drugs in our community. The suppressive effect of continuing enforcement action combined with increasing efforts to divert users to services through the work of the Community Health and Safety Section is part of an overall community approach to combat the drug epidemic, specifically heroin addiction in our region. Now, I recently spoke at a community health forum at Edmonds Community College, and the stories about heroin addiction that we're dealing with in our community is at epidemic levels now. And what I want to assure you, based on some of the stuff we're going to talk about, is that the police department isn't just a law enforcement arm of the community, that we are looking at other kinds of programs, other kinds of approaches to assist where we can to help with this wicked problem. You got traffic? Great. Your traffic section is staffed by one sergeant and 6 traffic officers. Traffic officers are tasked with responding reactively to traffic issues as well as for developing proactive strategies to make our roadways safer. In 2015, your traffic unit issued over 5,500 traffic infractions and investigated over 1,300 collisions. As with patrol officers, our traffic officers have thousands of community contacts annually, and these contacts are often with community members and visitors who have otherwise very limited police interaction. An additional function of these officers is the review of photo enforcement violations, which in 2015 included more than 44,000 reviews. The staff time spent on these reviews equates to approximately 0.75 FTE. Next slide, please. Thank you. The Special Operations Section is a proactive team who responds to a myriad of issues for the city. They are tasked to respond to hotspots or evolving criminal activity that is not amenable to traditional patrol work. A primary responsibility of the unit is continued work on gang issues in the city. Recently, they have dedicated significant efforts to the Spruce Park neighborhood issue, which includes 2 rival gangs seeking to claim this area as their own. In this case, SOS worked closely with Community Health and Safety, who was the liaison with Parks Department. These groups came together as a team to address the issue from a collaborative enforcement and interdepartmental approach to assist the community in addressing a very serious problem. These officers are not only an enforcement arm when it comes to gang issues. They also reach out to families of those involved in gangs to provide education and outreach to partner with them to dissuade their family members from this type of activity. This partnership includes other community organizations, as evidenced by the Spruce Park investigation, where they brought adult protective services in to assist with the family of a local gang member. Special Operations also works on the most prolific and or violent offenders who affect your city. They develop intelligence by working with patrol officers and detectives to most effectively address these issues. SOS is also tasked with monitoring level 1 and level 2 sex offenders in the city by conducting address verification checks. In 2015, this included more than 100 checks on sex offenders in the city. SOS is also the department's primary response to issues of prostitution and human sex trafficking in our city. Staffing for the Lynnwood Jail includes 1 commander, 2 sergeants, 12 booking officers, 1 electronic home detention and community service officer, and 1 court security officer. The detention program is responsible for the care and custody of pretrial arrestees and incarcerated persons for the Lynnwood Municipal Court. In 2015, custody officers booked over 3,000 people into Lynnwood City Jail and over 4,600 charges. The jail contracts with a medical service provider for part-time nursing staff to ensure that inmate medical needs are addressed. At any one time, a significant number of inmates are under medical care for withdrawal from street drugs, primarily heroin. I had a conversation, in the upper left picture is one of our contract nurses, and I had a conversation with her just last week. In fact, Mr. Wally Webster and I were walking through the jail, and I was giving him a tour, and she was there and we spoke with her. And we just asked her what she saw primarily as a contract nurse in the Lynnwood City Jail. And she said that 90 to 95% of all inmates that come into Lynnwood City Jail that she sees are either drug or alcohol addicted, and that the primary purpose is to provide them medical attention through the withdrawal period. It's a significant, significant issue that we're dealing with in our community, and not just in our community, but all communities. Next slide. Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry. Let me back up. The department is currently proposing to earmark $500,000 out of 105 to construct a multi-purpose room for inmate recreation, access to fresh air, and programming courses. The jail has been working with the Community Health and Safety Program to develop mechanisms to connect inmates with service to address underlying causes of recidivism. Most jail staff have also been through the 40-hour crisis intervention training to provide them with tools to de-escalate situations. This training is reinforced through departmental in-service training sessions on an annual basis. It is the expectation of your jail officers to provide service to the inmates in a compassionate and fair manner while they are incarcerated at the Lynnwood City Jail. Thank you. Next slide. The police administration is charged with mission, vision, and value alignment to ensure that the work being performed meets the goals intended. A key component of this function is to ensure that the overall police function is being conducted in a constitutional, ethical, and transparent and effective manner. The administration serves as the linking point with other city departments and community stakeholders. We recognize that the law enforcement function is closely linked with the overall effectiveness of city government, and that a collaborative effort is necessary to enhance the quality of life for our residents and visitors. A key function of the administration program is the hiring, retention, professional development, and discipline of department employees and their actions. As mentioned earlier, ensuring that we are hiring officers who will represent our values effectively and then providing them with the tools to do their job is the foundation for effective community interaction. Building trust and striving to enhance those relationships with our diverse community now more than ever enhances the legitimacy of our profession. Fair, just, and equitable law enforcement requires a dedicated management team. Support functions include the records program, which is staffed by 0.8 of a support services manager and 7 police clerks. The records program is tasked with the management and auditing of all police reports, management of law enforcement databases, and addressing all public records disclosure requests, in addition to serving community members who come into the department for assistance. Thus far this year, our staff have processed over 1,000 public records requests. Our evidence program is staffed by 0.2 support services managers, so the 0.8 of his time is with records and 0.2 of his time is with evidence, where he oversees 2 evidence technicians. This program is responsible for the intake, tracking, and disposal of all property and evidence. In 2015, the evidence unit processed over 7,200 pieces of evidence and over $450,000 of seized assets. The planning, training, and accreditation program is staffed by 0.3 of a commander, 1 training sergeant, a training officer, and a training technology officer. In addition to managing the department's training, this program also manages 3 part-time police cadets. As discussed earlier in the presentation, the training component is critical to providing officers with not only technical expertise to provide the best community service, but also the emotional intelligence tools and training to ensure that our officers are representing the department and our city in the most procedurally just manner. So this slide represents how our programs tie into the community vision and the vision statements. And when you look at this slide, you know, we had a lot of conversation about where the diamonds, if you will, the marks should go. And part of the conversation is, well, every program should have every mark on every column, but we wanted to try to drill down a little bit more rather than just quickly say that every program should do it. So we really try to focus each of the programs, and I think a comment earlier was, you know, the subgroups, if you will, of a department, the different units, and what their specific functions are, and how they can tie directly into the mission, vision, and values. I mean, the challenge really is how do you get a support staff person to contribute to the mission, vision, and value? Because we think of the police department, we always think of the officer in uniform, but there's so much more that goes into policing than just that. So this slide represents how our programs tie into the community vision and vision statements. Before our community can move forward, there must be a feeling of safety and security. The police department plays a vital role in providing the foundation of safety so that our vibrant community can thrive. We thought carefully throughout this BFO process about how we were meeting the vision and used that process to develop where we're trying to go in the future. So I've presented many of these highlights during the presentation. During the biennium, we were able to do a few things. We wanted to highlight these for you. One, we implemented a new computer-aided dispatch and records management system, which included significant training for staff and adjustment of workflow procedures. And I'll tell you that process isn't done. We are continuing to adjust those workflows and continue to provide training. And that's a regional program that we're involved in there. We implemented a jail medical program, which the council approved in 2014. This program was necessary to bring our jail into compliance with state statutes and best practices. Furthermore, this was the right thing to do to care for the inmates, especially those going through drug withdrawals or dealing with significant medical issues. I would like to thank the council for their support of that program in the previous budget. Additionally, the department continues to examine policy, mission, vision, and value alignment as evidenced on this slide. Most recently, the department implemented the use of naloxone, and within a week of training has already resulted in one of our officers saving the life of a 19-year-old boy who had overdosed on heroin. We will continue to look for collaborative and non-traditional ways to assist our community. During this biennium, we continued development of the community health and safety section, which will be discussed more in our additional funding request. Our challenge really is, what do we want to accomplish in 2017 and 18? Not what do we want to maintain, what do we want to continue to provide, but what do we want to accomplish? What do we know what success looks like? How are we going to measure that? Where are we going? While maintaining our current service, we are striving to strategically enhance our community and business outreach efforts department-wide. We want to grow the police department's community health and safety section to broaden its collaborative effort with other departments in a strategic manner by working with our other city departments in a formalized process. In the first quarter of 2017, we anticipate receiving the department efficiency study that we're going through right now. Those recommendations will come, and we'll work collaboratively with the city to implement these recommendations where practical through the next biennium. We will continue to be active participants on the task force on police relations with communities of color. In this biennium, we hope to set goals and objectives for moving forward and begin to strategize with our community partners to enhance our relationship with the communities that feel underserved by the Lynnwood Police Department. We will be going through the accreditation process in 2017. Which will provide us with an external review of how we are adjusting to new best practices both regionally and nationally. We are planning on implementation of jail services and the introduction of programming opportunities to attempt to connect our inmates with resources or to provide them with tools to keep them from reoffending. We are also continuing to work through consolidation efforts in several areas, and a lot of these you're familiar with, of course, the 911 centers, narcotics and the South County narcotics task forces, and the South County emergency radio system known as SIRS. This pie chart slide here shows the percentage of the police budget by program. The police administration percentage is significant due to the reallocation of expenses to the departments. Those reallocations will be discussed further in the next slide. And I think that you've probably been given a lot of information on the reallocation of costing to different departments, so you'll see these numbers adjusted. I'm sure this isn't anything new. I'm sure the other departments presented this as well. This table provides a breakdown of our proposed budget by program. You can see significant increases in several categories. The primary drivers of these increases are the reallocation of expenses and labor costs. As we constructed the budget, we scrubbed each line item in each program to look for savings. In most areas, our requests from 15, 16 to 17, 18 were flat. The police program is a service delivery program with little offset of revenue generation. We must ensure that we develop our police programs and policies with the focus on city mission and public safety service delivery and not on revenue generation. The next slide will illustrate the impact of the reallocation of costs and increased labor costs that are the only increases in this proposed budget. As we examine this slide, it is important to note that the changes listed as previously in non-department existed in the city budget. I think that's how they're cited, as previously in non-department. Yeah, that's how they're referenced. But they were not allocated to the police budget. I want to emphasize that point. And showing as an increase to the budget should not be an increase to the overall city budget, but rather the allocation of existing budgetary items to the departments. Since the police department is the largest department in the city, the impact is proportionally higher than for other departments. But the overall city general fund budget should be unaffected by these particular shifting of funds. Most of the reallocation of funds was placed in police admin. That's a choice that we made, which is why the program appears to be significantly increased. This includes the ATS contract, in which the program contract expenditure is in the police department budget, but the offsetting revenue is not. When the comparative budgets are first examined, it appears that the police department has increased our proposed spending by approximately 19% or $6.3 million. You'll see that in the bottom right-hand or the far right-hand column. However, a closer examination of each category is required to really understand what's occurring. Non-department expenses and other department reallocation costs for these items, as I mentioned, as noted in the table, equate to approximately $3 million. Salary and benefit increases, as noted in this table, equate to approximately $2.2 million. And as you can see, the benefit calculation difference is significant between the two. When you look at employee benefits from 15-16 to 17-18, that's as much as the salary portion overall as well. Overtime expenses increases are impacted by the salary and benefit increase as well. As you will see in the next table, department staffing is significantly less than it was pre-recession. As a reminder, the department previously had 80 police officers and is now budgeted for 70. 10 fewer officers is a significant impact to staffing, thus vacancies, injuries, other leave is more impactful to police operations. Again, because we're a 24/7 operation, when we don't have that, we do have to backfill in some way. Additionally, the department continues to increase its effort in community outreach events, which often require staff to work outside their normal working hours. Other increases in categories are a combination of prior budgetary requirements mixed with reallocation of certain portions of costs, such as insurance costs and fleet, telephone, cell phones, etc. The cost for the rental of our evidence facility, which was discussed previous, which had previously been owned by the city, was shifted to the police department in 2015. The shifting of the cost is indicated shows a $200,000 increase in that line item because those expenses were moved over to the police department as well. The increase in employee travel is completely tied to the Washington State Academy funding. The state now charges for partial tuition, and we cover all housing and food costs for each recruit. So the state is trying to recover some of their costs of sending recruits down. And so that is something that wasn't there several years ago that is in place now. Outside of reallocated expenses and contractual increases, you will see that the category of other expenses, we actually decreased our proposed budget by $56,000. So police positions. This slide shows the department staffing by position. It is important to note that in 2009, pre-recession, the police department was staffed with 117 FTEs, including 80 commissioned officers. The current staffing is 69 commissioned officers, or 101 total FTEs, in the general fund, one officer FTE in Fund 104, and one IT FTE, technology FTE, in Fund 105. Now more than any time in my career, the expectations that our community has for their police department is increased, and our actions are carefully scrutinized. From hiring practices, policy development, training, and equipping, to each action taken by your officers, the public is demanding the police officers be able to diffuse a situation, make correct split-second decisions, and interpret legal decisions to apply them correctly in the field, while providing procedurally just, transparent, and unbiased law enforcement services. To effectively accomplish this, we need leaders, managers, and supervisors to be highly trained and committed to their duties. We need to screen, train, and equip our officers and provide them with the tools and staffing to effectively provide services. I and a few of the police managers recently attended a Department of Justice Civil Rights presentation, and the two common areas of weakness that the Department of Justice Civil Rights Division saw in agencies that struggle with relationships in their community were staffing and training. When they had officers or lack of staffing and officers engaged in one-on-one interactions with citizens or community members, the opportunity for an escalation of force was significantly heightened. When an officer doesn't have de-escalation training, when an officer doesn't have dealing with persons with mental health issues or persons in crisis, when an officer doesn't understand that a use of force continuum also can be reversed and go back the other way, de-escalation, and they lack the tools, they oftentimes engage in uses of force at a quicker rate. Training and staffing are the two most critical issues the Department of Justice saw around the country with agencies that were struggling with communities of color in particular. This program is also the most opportunity to tie together our city departments in a collaborative effort to address community issues. The city of Lynnwood and our region is in a period of growth. There are two new apartment buildings under construction now and many more projects underway. Light rail is closer than it sounds, and every growth estimate shows our population increasing. In the best case scenario, it takes us 1.5 years to put a new police officer in a position right now to serve the community. You have anywhere from 2 to 3 months hiring process. You have a 5.5 month long police academy now. Then we have a field training period, the FTO, after that. And so it typically takes over a year to a year and a half before you get a police officer in a car by themselves actually getting service for the money that you're paying. We must be strategic in our approach to staffing to avoid being continually behind service level demands. Your police department is focusing on doing what it can to provide the service expected by the community, but as we grow, even more will be asked. We approach this budget process with a focus of maintaining the services for our community and believe that the product that we have produced is conservative and considerate of the city's limited financial resources. We took the same approach with our additional funding requests, which are focused in one key area of need. In late 2014, the department launched the Community Health and Safety section with one officer. Today, Sergeant Cole Langdon fills that position, and we have grown the program to the point where the workload is more than the officer can effectively accomplish. Ironically, I would say that it's because of the success of the program that we need more people. It's efficient, it's effective, and we're to the point where it's hard to be more efficient or more effective with one staff member. This program has excellent possibilities to positively impact our community, especially the underserved and high utilizers of city services and resources. This program also has the most opportunity to tie together our city departments in a collaborative effort to address community issues. We have strived to develop exceptional working relationships with our friends in community development and parks. Our intent is to be open and collaborative with other departments. Together, we have managed to provide a multi-pronged approach to effectively address community issues and provide positive results for our community. However, these efforts have largely been informal or case-specific. We now see great opportunity for a strategic approach to develop short and long-term plans to improve our community. We see the program as having two different prongs. The first prong is the internal existing services that the Community Health and Safety section can provide, which are listed on the slide. As you can see, there have been admirable accomplishments, but there's still much work to do in this area. The second prong is the strategic, intentional collaboration with other city departments. An example of this work can be seen in the efforts to address community problems at Spruce Neighborhood Park, where we worked hand in hand with the excellent staff members of the Parks Department to address immediate public safety and parks concerns to make the park welcoming and safe for the residents there. Other examples can be found in our efforts to get services to our homeless and to link others in needs with services. Our additional funding request is all related to the function of community health and safety. The first part of this request is a school resource officer. The SRO position was cut during the recession, and the school district was unable to fund their portion of this position. And the department was unable to staff the position due to the reduction in officers. The School Resource Officer Program is a very valuable program to the overall public safety effort and to the school district. The SRO establishes an excellent working relationship with Edmond School District staff and established relationships with our teen population. The value of having this relationship cannot be overlooked. Our students are often the silent members of our community who often don't have a voice or relationship with police officers that serve them. We now find ourselves reacting to issues at the school only after the issue has happened, rather than having an officer there who can act as a liaison or, through their own presence, can deter and intervene on issues before they arise to a serious event. As part of this budget preparation, we're asking to have this position approved, and we will fund this position out of Fund 105 and the school district funding, or their revenue, offsetting that expenditure. During the summer months, this officer would augment the community health and safety section, including allowing us to examine bike patrols during the summer months, which was requested in the community vision statement. The school district is proposing to fund their funding of 50% of those expenses for the 9 months period of the school year. Their funding will not be approved prior to the end of our budget process. If their funding is not approved, we would not move forward with the establishment of this position or backfill the officer. So the district has asked us to move forward with the funding request, so they're able, in theory, to take it back to their constituency and propose it and offer that the city of Lynnwood has already agreed to partner if, in fact, they're able to fund it. Next, we have our social request for a social worker. Currently, we have limited access to community providers, and there's a lack of availability for us to have direct links to services in our community. If approved, we would have a certified professional to work in the field with our community health and safety officers to help link our underserved community members and divert our high utilizers to programs and resources where they are better served than through traditional law enforcement means. We also have limited resources in our jail to provide linking and transitional services to offenders who are struggling with chemical dependency, mental health issues, and/or homelessness. Linking them with resources will serve them much more effectively than releasing them and putting them in the same situation that resulted in their arrest to begin with. What we have discovered through this process is that there is a real need for additional effort in this area. We are asking for 2 additional officers for this program. These positions would be assigned directly under the direction, assigned under the direction of the Community Health and Safety Sergeant. These officers would be proactive in their effort rather than reactive to problems as they arrive. We currently have a band-aid approach to these issues. Our intent is to have the sergeant manage and develop strategic relationships with community service providers and link our community members in need with those services. The sergeant will also direct the activities of the officers in the field. These officers will work in concert out in the community and work with social workers so that we can most effectively lend aid to our underserved community members before we find ourselves trying to address an emergency after the fact. There are numerous opportunities for us to utilize the expertise and services of other city departments, and many services we can offer them to assist them in achieving their own goals. However, every department, including ours, is busy with their function, and we need a person to link this program into one effort rather than to only come together on a case-by-case basis. While this program is set in the police department, the effort for the community initiatives is truly collaborative. As you saw in the parks budget presentation, we worked together to develop the possibilities for this program that we each have requests within our own budget. As part of the discussions on community health and safety, we examined current issues facing our city, which include a request by Parks to have us reinstitute the Park Patrol program. This program was cut during the recession when the police department reduced the number of cadets that we had. Issues such as graffiti at Spruce Neighborhood Park or damage from those camping in the park caused city resource expenditures after the fact rather than having the activity discovered or deterred when it begins. During the Parks Department budget presentation, they provided their support of the Park Patrol hours, which was approximately $10,000. As we discussed in the police department, this budgetary item internally, we realized that we could not afford those staff hours and keep the cadets under their part-time hour restriction. If we add a 4th cadet, we could spread the Park Patrol hours amongst the 4 cadets while providing additional service to that position. Cadets have numerous duties at the police department, including running public fingerprinting services, which is a service that is in high demand. This table shows the costs associated with the requests that we've provided, which includes the 2 officers, 1 SRO, and 1 social worker with associated expenses. The table does not include the police cadet request. The number at the bottom of the table is the general fund request for these positions, which is the total less the school district reimbursement and the 105 salary for the SRO. I'd like to thank you again for allowing us to discuss our proposed budget this evening and our additional funding requests. We'll be happy to answer any questions. I must take a quick minute and thank Deputy Chief Nelson and staff member Connie Gaylor for all of their work in putting the budget together as well. I think no 2 people will be more relieved than those 2 when we're done this evening. And Commander Steichen as well, yes, of course. Thank you very much. Be happy to answer any questions if we're able.
Council Vice President Goodwin.
Thank you. Going back to the position that is split into thirds with Mountlake Terrace and Edmonds, I believe you said, is that something that looks like it's going to continue to be funded by those two jurisdictions in the near future as well, as
that
far
is
as we can tell?
Currently through an interlocal agreement
okay.
with those two cities that is ongoing.
Okay.
And so I don't anticipate a change to the funding of that particular position.
Okay.
We are in conversations about other funding related to the South County Task Force.
Okay.
But not that specific position, sir.
All right. Thank you.
Councilmember Goodwin, Cotton.
Thank you, Honor, and thank you, Chiefs, for being here tonight. First, I just wanted to clarify that in, let's see here, on slide, apologies here, on page 7, so it's the one where we're talking about police budget changes, the table with the orange on top. You had noted that the ones in parentheses were previously in non-department, the SNOCOM, the LEOF, and the SERS, and the DEM interlocal agreement. Are there any other elements that were out of non-departmental that got moved into your budget? Because the reason why I'm asking is I look at and evaluate the non-departmental budget, I see that it went down by about $4 million or so, but as I go through the budget, are there any other things that were in non-departmental, no matter how small, that did end up in this budget?
Yeah, I'm going to let Deputy Chief Nelson answer that. Okay. I want to make sure that we're using the term non-departmental in the same way that finance is, and so I want to make sure there's room for clarification there.
Okay.
I'm going to let Deputy Chief Nelson answer that.
Everything marked as previously non-departmental mm-hmm. Is from non-departmental.
Okay.
Now, there are budget items from other city departments that yep. came into our budget. I'd have to check on some of the fleet charges just to ensure none of those
okay.
were incurred there through the insurance.
Okay.
So, if you want to send that question, I can just verify that.
Yep, I will. Thank you. I want to make sure we're, and I know we're. This is the appropriate way that those things, you know, they get applied to the appropriate departments. I just want to make sure that I'm seeing the right things here. The other thing is on page 3.226 of the budget binder. I was wondering if we could clarify, these are the total number of FTEs authorized, but some of the positions are unfilled. Is that correct? Or is the numbers I'm seeing here in this table on page 3.226, is that currently everybody that's currently working in the city?
We currently have one vacancy that we're in background process on.
Okay, so I guess that totals at the bottom of the table that say 101.0, would we actually have true 100 FTEs working, but we have the additional vacancy?
It's actually 102
okay.
because of we have a police officer funded 104. This is just a general fund table.
Okay.
And then we also have the police department playing for an IT employee out of 105, but that's not incorporated into our FTE count for the department.
Gotcha, because that's ITs.
Correct.
Okay, so... Okay.
We're funding it, but it's not out of general fund.
Right. Because
yeah.
that's fund 102, correct?
Well, one is 105 and one is 104.
Okay. And then I'll relinquish the floor and I'll send you a list. Thank you.
Other questions? Councilmember Hurst?
Thank you. I've got a question on the caseload. You had mentioned detectives having, was it 40 property crime and 30 personal crime. Is there a national standard for caseloads at all?
Well, not that I'm aware of, unless you know anything different. No, no, sir. And that number is anecdotal. If you'd like me to provide you a specific number, I'd be happy to do that since we did discuss that.
Okay.
I guess I'd to follow up on caseloads, what I can say is caseloads, the caseload has a direct effect on the work. So the lower the caseload, the sooner a detective can get to a case, which typically results in better prosecution or better investigation, witnesses or where they still were, you can still find people. So the higher caseload is, the worse your cases get, which make them more difficult to work, which increases your caseload. And the converse is true if you're working a caseload, and I spend a significant amount of time in investigations. If you're working a caseload down in the 20s, you know, or teens, you can get to those cases faster, and therefore you can turn your cases over faster with better results.
I think it may also be relevant to the conversation to talk about the fact that the supervisor is also screening cases for solvability. And so he or she can adjust that number that is assigned to a detective based on the ability to either, you know, to screen them out if they're not workable. And so I think that also has a corollary effect, too. The higher the caseload, the more likely a supervisor is to close a case and not try to work it or assign it to a detective to work. So it does have a corollary effect that way as well.
Councilmember Sessions, did you have your hand up?
Yep. Thank you. Thank you for all your work on this. Can you remind us, Fund 105, is that a federally funded fund that is has limited ability, like limited use?
It's a bit of a conglomeration of different things. There are limited use funds there specific to the federal government. Mm-hmm. And then I'd have to get back to the other statutes. I don't know them off the top of my head for other 105 expenditures. And then 104 is restricted funding for drug enforcement.
Thank you. That's what I was getting at, was that they're restricted in that, just to confirm that they're restricted in that money is limited just to certain things, right?
Correct.
Okay. For the request for additional funding on the school resource officer, do we know how much the district is willing to help out?
We have an estimate based upon past mm-hmm. relationships with the school district, and I believe it's in the, well, it's not in that funding. If you look on the last page of the slides, request for additional funding, you'll see an estimate there right near the bottom.
Oh, thank you.
And that does include some estimate for other costs such as vehicle and usage and things like that. But obviously the school district would have to approve that funding, so that's our best guess.
And would this be an added officer or using an officer we already have?
No, it'd be additional officer backfill once we were able to put somebody in the SRO position.
And just to clarify, is this officer also available to respond at any time to larger needs in the city?
We'll have to take a look at the policies and response policy, but larger issues is right somewhat of a nebulous term. I could tell you that if there was an emergency or crisis, absolutely, officer would be able to respond. Just like if there was a crisis in our neighboring city, we would respond if it was significant enough too. So, absolutely available.
Okay. And the social worker, have we pursued any verdant grants for this position? I know it's not really good to do a full-time position with a grant for permanent funds, but just to get started.
I'm aware that Commander Steichen and Sergeant Langdon were pursuing a grant opportunity. I don't know the details of that, Councilwoman, and so I would have to find that out and respond back to you.
Okay, thank you.
And I will do so.
And then one last question. On the request for additional funding for the community health and safety for the two full-time or FTEs, are those for commissioned police officers or non-commissioned?
Those would be for commissioned police officers.
Thank you.
Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank
Good
you.
Job. Phew. I was wondering. Thank you. Council, I'd like to move on to item G, where we are going to entertain a presentation by our municipal court for the 2017-18 biennium. And Judge Moore and Paulette Revoir are coming to the table, our court administrator. Thank you. Do you have one, Judge? You got enough stuff. All right. Yeah, it's very, very magic. Very, very.
This shouldn't take long.
Let's hit the button.
We're here to ask you to reduce the number of FTEs who work at our court, and we don't expect a bunch of argument about that. And we're here to ask you for a massive $12,000 increase in our budget, and that's pretty much it.
Good night.
Been lovely chatting with you. We should do this more often.
He could.
I'm assisted tonight by our court administrator, Paulette Revoir, on my left. You all know Paulette. Also with us tonight, but there's not room at the table, is Rhiannon O'Neill, our operations supervisor, and Regina Mack, our probation department supervisor. You don't know how blessed we are to have the staff that we have making Lynnwood Municipal Court happen. I was explaining to the chief that the easy way to succeed in administering any kind of organization is to surround yourself with absolutely stellar people who are way smarter than you are, way more capable than you are, protect them and enable them to do a good job, and then take about 10% of the credit. Well, that's my policy for how to run Lynnwood Municipal Court, and it's working. It's working wonderfully well. There are, flip that thing, we have to get through these slides. There's a thing that says the municipal court is composed of an administration section that makes the court work and a case processing section that responds to all the stuff that gets filed there and a probation department that exists to help the people who we think we can help most by applying some rehabilitative services to them. You're right on top of it. It has been difficult, flip to the next one, it has been difficult for me to express what it is that we do in the municipal court in terms of the city's vision, and I apologized to the mayor for this already, because frankly the city's vision is not what drives what we do. The United States Constitution drives a lot of what we do. The decisions of the United States Supreme Court drive what we do. Our state constitution drives what we do. Our state Supreme Court, both in its decisions and in its rules of court, drive what we do. The state legislature drives what we do by the laws that they enact, and occasionally an ordinance gets adopted by the city council that drives what we do, and all of that takes place outside the frame of the vision that you all have been working so hard and so well on for so long. So it's been difficult for us to make the language shift from court talk to vision talk, but we did as best we could and have set forth where we perceive our programs fitting within the community division, vision rather, in that slide. I have no idea why we put this slice of the pie chart in here. I guess it's because everybody has to have one slice of the pie chart, or the purchase price of the software that produces them is not adequately justified. So there's ours. I hope you like it. Then the mayor told us that we would be granted the opportunity to brag. And I love to brag about Lynnwood Municipal Court. Flip the thing. I'm going to let the boss run through for you some of the really magnificent accomplishments that the court has realized in the last 2 years. Boss?
I'd be happy to, Your Honor. Thank you. Yes, I did turn it on. Thank you. It was difficult to select the few that we have there, but I'm going to take a little bit of time to go through those because I think it's important. Prior to our implementation of a program called Collector, court legal specialists would manually receipt payment transactions into our case management system, JIS. These are collection payments. The court receives approximately $1 million annually in payments from our two collection companies. Collector integrates with our current case management system, JIS, and automates that collection process receipting, which frees up time for our legal specialists to do other tasks. Prior to OneLingua, which is an online interpreter scheduling software, interpreter scheduling was done manually by telephone and email. The program automates the interpreter scheduling process, again, freeing up legal specialist time to perform other tasks and duties. A while back, we converted from FTR recording to AV Capture to record our court proceedings. AV Capture allows the court to publish the court proceedings on our website. Individuals can go onto our website and listen to specific hearings the day that they are held. Parties can also purchase a copy of the recording by visiting the website, AV Capture's website. In the past, staff would spend time making CD copies of these recordings, which took quite a bit of staff time. We are no longer making copies of recordings unless it's for an appeal. Bench warrants, summonses, and infraction by mail notifications were previously printed on three-part NCR forms, which were rather costly, and in addition to being expensive to print, they were time-consuming and unreliable in printing process. With the implementation of plain paper printing, the court can now print these forms on 8.5 by 11 paper, saving both time and money. One measure to use to track a court's performance is to look at the court's clearance rate. A court's clearance rate ideally is 100%. This means the court is adjudicating or disposing of cases equal or greater to the number of filings. Our clearance rate is 103%. Clearance rates help a court forecast potential backlog, balance staff and judicial resources, and identify case types that may require additional resources. The reliability and integrity of court files is determined by the percentage of files that can be retrieved within established time standards and meet established standards for completeness and accuracy. Our court has implemented a file audit process that will ensure that we meet these standards, thus ensuring public trust and confidence in our court here in the city. Judge Moore participates in a countywide search warrant on-call program. Participating judges from the county's district, municipal, and superior court receive telephone calls from various law enforcement agencies 24/7. Judge Moore has personally expressed to me that he enjoys the calls he receives at 2 a.m. His participation in this call rotation ensures that our Lynnwood Police Department will have access to a judicial officer any time of the day or night for a search warrant. The municipal courts in Marysville, Everett, Lynnwood, Monroe, and Edmonds collaborated to establish a warrant recall program. For example, if a defendant resides in Lynnwood and is eligible, he or she could appear here at our court to quash their Marysville bench warrant. After a small fee is paid, the warrant is recalled, the defendant is provided with a court date. The result is countywide reduction in the costs associated with service of bench warrants, including jail costs. Okay. A few of our highlights. Earlier this evening, we had a contract on the consent agenda for a case processing program. OCORT is the name of the program. We are going to be transitioning to 100% paperless over the next biennium. Currently, we are 100% paperless in our infractions, and we are paperless post-closure for criminal. This O-Court program will allow us to be 100% paperless, and all of our criminal forms will be online. They will be dynamic forms, and we will have e-signature. So this is going to be a big project for us that we'll be working on most of the next year. We would also like to establish a warrant notification project. The changes we have made for efficiency have allowed us to have extra staff to have time to contact defendants after a warrant is issued, advise them that they have a warrant, and the ways that they may be able to clear the warrant. Hopefully that will reduce the number of arrests. We also would like to get our jury questionnaire online, so that folks can go online and fill out their questionnaire and they don't have to use a stamp and put paper in the mail.
One of the grand parts of the areas which Paulette has highlighted is that by achieving these sorts of efficiencies, we're able to do more work with fewer people. It's amazing. That allows us then to move into areas where we have said in the past, gee, if we only had the staff, we would love to do this. And we're able to do some of those things now without coming to you, asking you for additional resources. Go to the budget change slide. This is a very deceptive slide because it looks like we're asking you for more money when in fact we're not. We're not asking for higher salaries and benefits. That's just the product of the negotiations that affect the salaries and benefits of all of the employees in the city. We're not asking for additional funding for all of those things that you see were cleverly transferred out of IT's budget and placed into ours. Well, because there's some neutral. They don't change what it costs to be the city. You notice that our copying costs are going down. When we finally get down to the very few things that we're asking for, we needed to replumb our telephone system because telephone lines are what connect us with the administrative office of the courts, and that's our link to the data information system that all courts run on. And then we had to get me one of those stupid, demonic iPhone devices that you lug around with you. We did that because I really needed to be more fully occupied between midnight and 5 a.m., and it's a delight to be able to serve the larger community, getting phone calls for search warrants from troopers in Arlington and Everett detectives, as well as members of the Lynnwood Police Department. Notice also that I wasn't kidding about reducing the staffing of the court. We had some rather curiously chopped up positions, and we're able to reorganize, though that print is probably too small for you to read, we are able to reorganize the way in which we utilize these people to reduce by a quarter of a position our total FTEs. The concluding illustrations show you graphically what I've been bragging about just in words. The first one, remember that courts are demand regulated organizations. By that I mean the amount of work that comes in the door every day determines how much the court is going to work that month and that year. Well, what this chart does is it shows you that our staffing has been held to a continuous level since 2013, while in every year our filings have increased, our workload has increased. Were it not for the economies that we've been able to achieve, we wouldn't be able to do that. And we would be here asking you for additional positions. But in fact, those increased efficiencies have enabled us to do more with less. I also wanted that the next slide to be here because not all filings are equal to all other filings. By that I mean some cases are resolved very quickly. The court doesn't have to touch the file very many times before it's a closed file and you're moving on to the next piece of business. Perhaps the most labor-intensive thing that we do is a DUI prosecution. And I thought you would be intrigued to compare the DUI filings in Lynnwood Municipal Court with those of some comparable courts, the courts in Monroe, Marysville, Everett, and Edmonds. As you can see, by a factor of, well, right up 2 to 1, we handle more DUIs than any of those sister courts. And yet, Everett Court sits with 2 full-time judges. We're able to do twice as much DUI work with 1. So I offer that as further evidence for the kind of efficiency that I'm bragging about tonight. One of the reasons that that's possible is that we have some really fantastic training that takes place inside the office. Rhea is primarily in charge of that and does a killer job. We have a great training program within the office, even though you people viciously and callously slashed our training budget years ago and forgot to put it back. But somehow we're able to make up for that internally. Therefore, the sum of what I have to say to you is, we're doing great. Kindly do nothing that would screw that all up.
Council President.
Thank you, Your Honor, and Your Honor. I'm never quite sure whether to refer to you as Your Honor or Reverend in that we share that peculiar vocation, but congratulations to all the staff of the municipal court on a job very well done. I was just curious, Judge Moore, about this last slide that you showed us. In addition to the obvious efficiency that it shows of the municipal court here in Lynnwood, and of course your good self, to what do you attribute this enormous difference between Lynnwood and these other cities in DUI filings?
Lynnwood chooses, let me start a different place. One of the reasons for having a municipal court is so that on a smaller level than a county, you can bring into effect the priorities that you as a community think are most important. Lynnwood has believed for the last 15 years that DUI enforcement is tremendously important in this community. So the police have devoted a lot of resources to DUI enforcement. The prosecuting attorney's office responds to that by rather aggressively prosecuting DUI cases and doing a great job with it. Now, there's other stuff, however, that ends up receiving less attention as a consequence of that sort of resource allocation. I'm sad, for example, that because of economic constraints, I used to be able to always impose a day or two of jail time, albeit one that people could do through community service, for every shoplifting case in the city of Lynnwood. I'm no longer able to do that. I just don't have the budgetary resources to do that. Well, when you weigh the two, the value of increased DUI enforcement is greater than the value of placing that emphasis on shoplifting, a nonviolent property crime. So in order to raise some things, you let some things sink a bit, I'm sad to report.
All right. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Other questions? Yeah, Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you very much for being here tonight. As I was reading through the information that ended up in our book, there was some discussion around space limits in terms of your offices and that type of thing. Also, I was wondering, have you brought to the table your space requirements? And if so, what was the outcome of that discussion, since I'm new?
Sure, that's okay. A great question. The administrative office for the courts has a way of looking at everybody's caseload and telling them how many judges it ought to take to be able to handle their caseload. And they look at ours, and we need 1.54 judges to do what one judge does in Lynnwood. But we're never going to have 1.54 judges because we don't have a space in which a second courtroom could be operating at the same time as the courtroom in our present facility. Mm-hmm. We, a number of years ago, I don't remember how many back.
2011, I believe.
Was it 2011? Went through a very large, very expensive process with consultants and people who know about such things to come and talk to the police department, to the jail, and to us about what it would take to adequately provide a facility for the court that was co-located with the police department for security and co-located with a jail so as not to have to transport prisoners back and forth. The cost is absolutely breathtaking. And as so often happens when there's a lot of work put in by a lot of people on a really great study like that, we congratulated one another, we thanked one another, and we put it on a shelf. And it's sitting there, and you're free to read it if you like. It's still valid. It says, I don't have any place for a jury to deliberate. I don't have a space in which I can gather 30 potential jurors and separate them from the other people coming and going in the court as they need to be separated. The probation office is too small. The probation office is insecure. The clerk's office is too small unless you're a chipmunk. We have enormous space problems, but short of funding a new civic justice center, which would include a new police station and a new jail, I don't anticipate that those problems are going to be relieved. Great question. God bless you.
Thank you. Every day, he blesses me.
Amen.
As a follow-up to that, you also had mentioned about that not every city has to have a court. So have you looked into, by chance, what that would look like? Mm-hmm. Would you mind sharing?
Every now and then, somebody whose breath is taken away by what it costs to run a municipal court says, well, at one time, didn't we just send all of our cases down the street to South District Court and have them filed there and prosecuted there? And it's true, we did. We did. I remember those days. I sat as a judge pro tem in South District Court when we used to get some of those Lynnwood cases. The problem with that sort of pie-in-the-sky solution to the cost of the total cost of having your own municipal court is that it doesn't pencil out. It doesn't even come close to penciling out. When you take what the filing costs would be to file all of our cases there, then look at the transportation problems we'd have physically moving all of our incarcerated defendants back and forth between here and South District Court in vehicles that don't yet exist and would have to be acquired by police officers who don't yet exist and would have to be retained and added and funded and trained to do that sort of work. When you think about then having to pay for every case that you put on probation, when you think about the economies that you lose when, unlike having your own municipal court where I can ask the police to give me their duty roster, and when I schedule police officers to come and testify in my court, I can make sure that we do that when they are on duty. You can believe that no district court is going to do anything remotely like that. And so you need to be prepared for a god-awful amount of overtime, police overtime, in what happens as a consequence of that. We did some numbers.
Sure did.
You want to say some concrete numbers?
There we go. So I, using 2015 caseload data from the Administrative Office of the Courts and our filings, calculated filing fees alone, filing in the district court, the city's court budget would increase by 38%.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate you answering my questions.
It's breathtaking, isn't it?
It is, really.
38%.
And, yeah.
One thing that's important to take into account is that photo enforcement filings are infractions. They're covered by the court rules as infractions. They're treated as infractions. They're entitled to hearings, mitigation, contested, and every photo enforcement filing is the same filing fee as a speeding ticket.
Thank you very much.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor, and thank you, Your Honor. I'll follow suit with that. I just had a quick question about interpretive services. Mm-hmm. Where I didn't see that, and that might fall under the category down too much in the weeds, Ian, stop asking questions about laundry list items, but I just want to know what the trend we're seeing in the city is for that. And is it a very impactful service that we're needing to augment our services with, or is it really kind of a blip?
It's real expensive.
Okay.
Interpreters of the quality that they have to be court interpreters are real expensive. What we were able to do, and I'm really proud of how this worked out, was to move our cases where we needed interpreters onto just a few calendars per month. That way, you don't have the same interpreter, the one who speaks to Greena, coming on Monday and again on Wednesday and again on Friday, and charging you a $200 minimum fee to show up each day, producing a $600 bill. If instead you can take all three of those cases and say, Wednesdays at 10 o'clock, that's going to be interpreter day. The Tigrina interpreter comes and is able to handle all three cases in 2 hours, and we pay that person $200 instead of $600. Some of that scheduling equipment we bought helps produce that result. It's kind of neat because the courtroom sounds like the foyer to the General Assembly of the United Nations on those days, but it works really, really well.
Great. Thank you, Your Honor. And just as I'm looking at the budget, does that typically fall into the services and supplies line items in the budget, or is that a follow-up?
So the interpreter costs are actually under our administration program.
Okay.
And they're for services. And the reason they fall there is it's very difficult to divide the interpreter costs by program because, as Judge Moore stated, we have interpreter calendars. And it's not just the language type that we combine together, it's case types. Mm-hmm. So you'll have a Spanish interpreter present. He's interpreting for 10 different cases. Two might be criminal, two might be photo enforcement. Couple might be infractions, and so it's really impossible to take that fee and divide that out by the program, so we are keeping that in administration.
Okay.
Fair. And we're not allowed to recoup those costs.
Right.
The state statute is very clear,
right,
that the court may not ask the individual served by the interpreter to pay any part of those costs, right, which is appropriate.
Although, if I may add.
Yes.
We have been part of an interpreter reimbursement program that the state has had for many, many years. And we only receive a small reimbursement annually. And we just received a letter that we've been selected to continue on in the program. There's only a handful of courts across the state that are doing this. So we're going to get around $7,500 over the next year. But it's something. Mm-hmm. And what we, in exchange, agree to do is provide them with data. Accurate data about the interpreters we're using, which ones are certified, which ones are registered, which ones are court qualified. And for that, we receive a very small reimbursement.
Awesome. Thank you very much to both of you.
You bet.
Councilmember Sessions?
Thank you. Thank you both. And all of you for coming. Good information.
Well then, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Your Honor.
We'll see you
soon.
Good to see
ya.
See you soon.
Always good to see ya. I'm not reaching today.
Oh. All right, you guys okay? Last presentation? Okay, so we'd like to invite Fire to the table. This is item H. We will entertain the 2017-18 budget presentation for Fire, and I see Chief Cockrum, Scotty DiBenedetti, Misty Burton is coming.
Make sure you mention me.
And at this time, Councilmember Sessions has recused herself from this item so as to avoid any potential conflict of interest. Later. Where's your water?
Dang it. Ready?
Yeah.
All right. Welcome. Council President Boyer, Mayor Smith, Council Member Scott Cogram, Fire Chief. We're pleased to be here tonight. I have on the at the table here with us is Battalion Chief Scott DiBenedetto and Misty Burke, and they've done the bulk of the work on the budget for us over the last several months, and we have a good presentation for you. After listening to the police and knowing what some of the others have said, we have a very similar story, so we'll kind of go through that, and we'll promise to have you out of here by 11:30. At the latest. I just, yeah. Well, I've had enough coffee. It just kicked in, so we're ready to roll. So we'll follow along with the presentation. It has a pretty similar format, surprisingly, as everyone else. But our mission is, and purpose is, the Lynnwood Fire Department is committed to the safe and livable community. We safeguard people, property, and the environment through education, prevention, and emergency response using innovation and compassion. And we do that. We have some of the best paramedic and firefighters that I've ever seen here, and they are compassionate to our citizens here. A department overview, we have the fire department, administrative operations, and fire prevention staff. In the audience, we have Chief Gates and Chief Seeloft who take care of those for us. What you don't see here is in their operations, We do normally would have an EMS department, a training division, and we do have a community paramedic. Now, some of those positions are being filled from some support that we're receiving during a blended management. Chief Seeloff is actually running the training division for both fire district and the city of Lynnwood, and he's also stepping up and doing a lot of work with operations along with the battalion chiefs that we have that have been working over there. Fire programs that we have an administration program, staff training. Under operations, we have admin, emergency medical service. We broke out a few of these categories that are new to this budget that we didn't have before, so that because we have program managers who actually run varying departments, and we wanted to have them identified budgets so that they knew how much money they had, how much overtime that they had, and how to run those efficiently. So with those, we have the personal protective radios, pagers, self-contained breathing apparatus, and small tools. We have a fire prevention program. Chief Gates here tonight. We have emergency management administration. We have a hazmat and a rescue program that are regional programs. You can see from our community vision that we touch in a variety of different aspects of the community vision. Chief Gates wanted me to point out that fire prevention has them all. So. Okay, moving to the next page there. You can see by our budget breakdown that operations and operations EMS make up the majority of our budget. The split on this, the reason that there's a split on this is that there's actually a 60-40 split. We have to account for the EMS levy money that we have come in. So that's why the operations admin, which is really with all the firefighting assets that we have a lower percentage than operations EMS. The administration portion of this used to be a much smaller percentage. That's where we placed all of the non-departmental funds that you've been hearing about for many presentations. You can see staff training, and we'll cover some more of these as we move along. Staff training is 1%. That's really how we send our firefighter paramedics down to Harborview to receive some CE training. And there's also our firefighters, if they take some continuing ed, get reimbursed for that based on their contract and that sort of thing. Our fire prevention, 8%, and then others, 2%. So that's really just our service and supply line. So our service and supply line is actually pretty low, but that accounts for all of our EMS supplies, turnouts, fire prevention, or all of the other items that we use for that. The highlights for 2015-16 include our call volume, which we've been talking about really for a couple of years now, but our call volume is just off the charts, over 20% increase just really in this last year. We have gone into a blender management agreement with Fire District 1. There's some cost savings associated with that we'll see later. Some programs that we've done, the local has stepped up and has really taken on fire camp program along with Misty. They donate all of their time for a week-long program for the last 2 years and bringing in a number of kids and introducing them to the fire service, which is a great program. We've done four Map Your Neighborhoods and a variety of other disaster preparedness efforts over the last year. Fire prevention activity and resources, they continue to be overwhelmed by the volume of growth and work that needs to be done there. We have regionalized a community paramedic program with a Verdant grant with Fire District, and we have some oversight that occurs through the Fire District with that helps us out a lot. Misty wrote a grant. We've got a $380,000 state mobilization grant for equipment and training this year. We've increased our EMS transport revenue through just call volume, really, and also just kind of the way that we have watched the money come in from the third-party vendor that does that. We make sure that all of our billing is done correctly, all of the paperwork is signed and has the appropriate narratives in them to achieve the best financial result we can from that. And then we've done quite a bit of disaster outreach and prep. All right, 2017-18 goals and highlights. So those really include, we have to do something to take care of the call volume that we have, but so safety for responders, proper PPE, personal equipment, proper training, and to meet the staffing level needs that we have. going into the increased demand for calls. Me, the standards of coverage response, this council and a previous council has adopted a standard of coverage response. It has to do with how soon we arrive on scene. So for basic life support, we have a standard of coverage, or we like to be there within 4 minutes and 30 seconds. Those go to standards of American Heart on how long it takes to for brain death if you aren't breathing and so on. 5:30 for advanced life support on scene, 5:30 on a fire or car crash, or what, 5 minutes and 30 seconds for a first arriving fire engine to be on scene. And then we like to have, for an effective fire force, we like to have everybody there within 9 minutes of that. So an effective fire force is about, it depends on the call, but about 15 to 17 different firefighters there. So that's three engines, a ladder company, two battalion chiefs, an ambulance company on that. So that's an effective fire force. We like to have that there. That has to do with the time it takes for a fire to reach a flashover stage. It takes about 6 or 7 minutes of a fire to come out of the incipient phase into a flashover stage. Once it hits a flashover stage, it makes it difficult to get in for a rescue, and survivability becomes limited. Fire prevention, of course, really, fire prevention is for prevention and education. They're there to really reduce the calls that we go on. If we can prevent the fire or prevent the accident or prevent the problem, then we don't have to respond to it. So we've talked about ways to reduce calls. One way is that you send out a fire prevention inspector to alarm system malfunctions, repeat alarm system malfunctions, and they go out and get that, those sort of things corrected. So their job is to do plan review, alarm and sprinkler system inspection and compliance. They are responsible, overall really responsible for fire education activities. They have a turnaround time result that they're trying to achieve to be in compliance with the code or the other plan checkers to make sure that our businesses and buildings are getting the plan reviews done, and then the inspections that go with that are completed with that. Over the last couple of years, we've seen, and we've probably heard all on the news, some of the increased costs of medical supplies. Drugs costs are going up from 100% to 800%. So we saw the epinephrine for that has gone up about 800%. Well, that is not out of the ordinary. And with the increased call volume that we have, we're using more medical supplies while we're out there. We have to replace some non-compliant equipment. We have a little bit of rescue equipment that is out of compliance with age, and we're part of the rescue team. And then we have a little bit of money in here for to study further the regionalization or regional outcome prospects. So go into the next page. Our story on the fire benefits, our budget summary, is not like the courts at all. It's a lot like the police department, in that administrative piece of that is where the majority of the non-departmental has gone, or all of the non-departmental. The difference between the 15, 16, and 17, 18 budget is about $2.17 million. About 1.913 of that is new non-departmental costs, so that's an increase of about $258,000. $258,000 increase is really in cost of health insurance and other benefits and wages for the administrative staff. You can see in the staff training, we've reduced that cost by about $318,000. And if you go down under personal protective equipment, small tools, radios and pagers, SCBAs, et cetera, we have that money used to come out of staff training, and we've added it into those other programs so that it can be better managed. So not unlike the police, our budget really is pretty well a status quo budget. The increases in costs that we have are wages and benefits and the non-departmental money that has come in. We've seen some, you know, pretty good costs in IT and those sort of things. So when the IT manager tells you his budget is about $500,000 less than it went to others, I know where part of it went. Okay, moving on to the changes. So again, I think this fire budget changes, this fairly well identifies where some of those changes occurred. We also added a little bit of money to the fleet, I think, to we had added some money in fleet in the that you have given us out of the transport money to help settle up some of our past non-full funding of our fleet, and we're making that up in finality this time. But this is where the majority of the money is coming out. Again, it's about the majority of this money is the non-departmental, and then the rest of it is salaries and employee benefits as it states here. So fire positions, you can see at the bottom here that we actually reduced one position going into the 17-18 budget. We had Dustin Nykirk that was with us. He left us and went to work elsewhere, so we haven't replaced his position. And so we're remaining with what you see here is with the 58 positions. So this kind of goes to illustrate some of the call volume increases that we're seeing in the fire department. So if you look down from, it has been a fairly steady increase, really from 2011 to 6,487 calls to what we're projected in 2016. We have 9,015 responses here. It'll probably be closer to 9,300 calls for service. That's a pretty big number. We have a unit, and actually I'll talk about it a little bit further into this, but some of our units like Aid 15 is probably getting close to 5,000 calls, between 4,500. And that's, for somebody who's been on fire engine for a lot of his life, about 3,000 is feeling busy, and that's on an engine that doesn't do transports. When you start hitting 4,000 and more than that, particularly when you're doing transports, that's a lot of calls. Calls for service down here at that line, the next line here. You can see that the number of firefighters for the city of Lynnwood have remained pretty stable from 2011. We're projecting that out, if we projected it out to 2022, and you can see the call volume increase with the same number of firefighters that we've had for really many years, well before 2011. I think we went from 8 to 10 firefighters on duty in the last 20 years. You can see the next slide here. This is a comparison to our neighbor, the Fire District 1. The calls per number of firefighters on duty. So you can see in 2016, the Fire District's about 129 calls per firefighter on duty. City of Lynnwood is at 202. So there's a significant difference in the workload that these two agencies perform, and you can see that projected out of that over the years. And actually, Station 14 has skyrocketed in calls as well. So there has been a little bit of a change in the behavior of responses to based on the New World application with AVL, now the closest unit response. Really, the change in that application has been, in the past, there's been a bit of an imbalance between the fire district and the city of Lynnwood for automatic aid, and so we've picked up most of that imbalance. So we're now at a fairly similar number of out and in automatic aid, but because we're at an imbalance of between 400 or 500 calls a year, we've now matched that. So part of the call volume increase is that. Part of the call volume increase has just been a natural increase that's been occurring around the region for the last several years. So everybody's experiencing the same kind of call volume increases. So for our requests, our goal here, and I think I've been talking about this since about 2015, I had a kind of a five-year thought of where I thought we might end up with the growth of the city, the impacts of the high density housing, the impacts of the light rail train station and that. And really just coming in here and recognizing that this is becoming quite the metropolitan extension of the Seattle area, and that we were going to see an increase in call volume. While I don't know that I predicted it would be in that not over 9,000 range, I did predict we'd probably be in the 8,000 range this time of year, but the increase has been more beyond what I would have expected. But to get on that five-year plan that I had, we actually missed 2016. I was hoping that by the end of 2022 that we would open up two more resources here. By 2018, one would have been another ambulance unit of some sort, and then by 2020, I guess it was, a ladder company to meet some of the high-density demands and I guess low-rise and the transportation issues that we're going to have. We didn't add any FTEs really in 2016, so now we're looking at how can we open another ambulance unit by the end of 2018. What we knew coming into this was that these, you know, it takes 10 people to open an ambulance, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We knew that coming in that trying to get 10 FTEs over 1 year was going to be an expense that was hard to overcome. And a department the size of ours with just two fire stations, it's a challenge to hire 10 people and have them and train them and get them through probation and do all of the things that we need to do to get them prepared. So we wanted to kind of stagger it. So now we're here to say that I don't know how we're going to be able to meet our response demands by the end of 2018, if, you know, for a variety of reasons, but if we even into by the conclusion of 17, I'm concerned that, you know, with 4,000 or 5,000 calls on one unit now, what it's going to be look like at the end of 18. So, but to get us to the end of 18, it will take 10 new firefighters to achieve that goal. That the cost of $1.84 million. Additionally, the Fire Prevention Department Division has their own demands. I'm sure that Paul Krause has come and or has or will come and talk to you about what the needs are for development and community development. Well, the workload that they achieve in that division, the next step of that belongs to the fire department. And so for us to keep pace with that workload, we need an additional person in there. So actually, this council and mayor have had funded that position through 2016. So we already actually have had that person in there. What we need for this is the permanent funding for that individual that's in there to be able to continue on. Now, you know, again, keep it in consideration that we have a fire life safety issue. We have, as we add these high-density housing units, these multi-story units, these train stations, the light rail development that's coming up, the workload for the fire departments is incredible. The high-density housing with the fire protection systems in there that they have requires somebody to inspect those to assure that they're in compliance. And as we build more and more of those that we have. Now, the city of Lynnwood has a history of having a strong fire prevention division. And we don't want to weaken that any, as we have a reputation for that, and we think that it has provided good service to the city. So we certainly, if we do not fund this position, this will be a regression to what we have in 2016 in that division, trying to keep up. We also, in over the last 2 years, in 15 and 16, the city council has been gracious enough to have an MOU along with our local for a battalion chief position. We've been working with that position and as a duty chief, kind of a hybrid of that position for the last 2 years. We anticipate if going into 2017-18 running over 10,000 calls for service a year. The supervision that they provide has been tremendous to the city. The supervision of trying to keep units in service, trying to move units where they need them, to manage the, you know, the complexities of the calls that are occurring in that. Really demand. They've really been trying to promote this position since I think at least 2006, and I think in a matrix study in 2010 they recommended this, and that's when we were running just over 6,000 calls. Or of course now we're going to hit 10,000, I believe. So the supervision that this brings to the city and the managing of the resources that have to manage these 10,000 calls that we're going to see is, you know, pretty important to us. They also have a pretty important piece to the succession of the city. If there's no next level management, there's no succession opportunities that exist here. Most of the chief officers here are old enough to retire, and so
yes.
So my concern is that what is the next level? And really, it's difficult to go from a line fire captain, fire officer, to a chief officer and an assistant chief position without going through the battalion chief level and getting that next level of supervision to understand a little bit more about budgeting, a little bit about more about process and discipline and all of the things that we need to do that for succession. And we just do not have much of it. We have more of a branch than a tree. And then we have some increased medical supply costs that, as I mentioned, that with the increased call volume, we're going to have some, and the increased costs of medical supplies. We did actually go into this and make it a pretty darn status quo budget. Matter of fact, we're a little concerned about if we do not receive any additional FTEs, that we're going to run ourselves out of overtime budget, because the FTEs for the first year will help to offset some of our overtime budget costs. So, because we did not plan, we did come in here planning that we would get some FTEs. We didn't actually recognize that we may not, because we're positive thinkers. So the next slide, this is from the capital facility plan that the fire district has put in place. Why this is important is this kind of talks about what the timelines are for additional units to respond into the city. So when you look at the yellow portions of the city, you can see kind of the two spots of green in the middle of the city there. But the highlights of yellow is the time it takes, that's between 4 and 8 minutes for the next unit outside of the city to respond into the city. So once our units are out on their 9,400 to 10,000 calls a year, the next unit that responds in here takes that much longer, and then the next unit after that takes that much longer. Now, the units, I know a little bit about what's going on in the fire district right now, and the units along the I-5 corridor are equally as busy as the units in the city of Lynnwood. So everybody is picking up Station 11, Station 18. So the Mount Lake Terrace station is overflowing with call volume also. So all of us are starting to see quite the dramatic increase. So their capability to supplement and be that second unit is really reduced also. So that's why it's important to have units here in the city of Lynnwood, so that we can meet some of those response time needs. And I will say that the city of Lynnwood absolutely has the busiest fire stations and fire resources of the Snohomish County. So moving on, balance in the budget. So transport fees, and this is really by not much magic of me, but by magic of call volume increases, really. Transport fees have gone up quite a bit. So I think in 15-16, we projected about $1.1 million in transport fees. In 2017-18, we're going to project, at least $2.2 million. So we're going to double that amount of money. Now, the problem is that if we can't do the transports because we don't have the resources in the city to do the transports, then we reduce that money. There's another bill that we've been talking about that we are a revenue source that is called Ground Emergency Medical Transport. I know we've been talking about it since I arrived here, but that we do anticipate kicking in into 2017. We expect to start seeing some revenue for that. We don't have a grasp on how much that money will be, but it will be more money. But we have kind of gone in with a $2.2 million projected revenue. And really, overall, our budget is... even with the increases, wages, and all that, we're covering about at least half the cost of our own budget just with transport fees that we're picking up. We did receive a verdant grant, so these are fees that are not reflected in our overall cost. So one of the positions that we have is a verdant grant that is for the community paramedic. So that's also a reduction of about $329,000. We have the EMS levy, which is worth about 44 cents per thousand right now, is worth $2.2 million a year, or 4.4 over the budget. We have an agreement with Muckle Teal. They pay for half of an MSO position, and that is Larry Hadlin, although we've kind of mixed up how that works right now. The city still is reflecting the cost avoidance of that and receiving the money from the city. So total revenues that we're receiving back is about $7 million. So additionally to that, with the blended management that we're doing and that we're all supporting, working hard to support, all of us in this room are, we have some cost avoidance. So we've cost avoided an EMS chief. The fire district is doing a tremendous job of picking up all of our EMS assistants. They're helping us with supplies, recertification, training. It's actually been quite a good deal for us. Chief Seeloft is handling the training for all of the fire district. We have a public educator and a falls prevention person from the fire district that are assisting us quite frequently, so that's a cost avoidance. We didn't replace a management analyst position. Chief Gates doing a tremendous job with fire marshaling for the entire South Snohomish counties, including the work that he's doing here, helping to guide and lead them through the light rail development that's going on, so that we're working together hand in hand on all of those sort of works. So with that, we'll take any questions. We appreciate your work in this. I know it's getting late, but this is important. We just do not know how we're going to go into 17-18 without any additional resource. It will be a struggle.
Vice President Goodwin.
Thank you. With the projected revenue of $2.2 million for the transport fees, if that has to do a lot with call volume, is that also becoming a greater expense because of the call volumes, wear and tear, overtime, anything like that?
Yeah, those do go hand in hand together. The advantage, the whole firefighter on an ambulance kind of a thing has some advantages, disadvantages. The advantages are that you'll have additional resources here as firefighter resources, so that when we do have the fire and they are here in service, their costs are offset by the transport fees. Here we're also fortunate that the Swedish hospital is where they do 90% of their transports to. So the turnaround time is very quick there at this point anyway. There may be a time when Swedish wall times, which is times that it takes to get a patient in there and turned over to the hospital, may grow. But right now our wall time is not very long, so we can get in there, get the patient turned over to the hospital and get them back in service. But yes, there are additional costs that go with medical equipment, the wear and tear on ambulances, and all of those sort of things.
Thank you, and thanks for the detailed work that you put into this. And I know that it takes a lot of effort to get this stuff done, so thank you very much.
Thanks.
Also,
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Honor. First of all, my hat's off to you, Chief, and your entire department. I mean, I'm just looking at the number of responses per firefighter. It's mind-boggling. So, thank you. The next is just a question about call volume with regard to the bar graph that indicated the EMS versus non-EMS fire, the gray and orange.
Mm-hmm.
I'm seeing that we've got a jump between 15 and 16 of 1,000 non-EMS fire calls. What do we know what the driver of that is? Is that just was it a really dry summer? What?
Well, it's all of those things.
Okay.
You know, one of them is that we did respond to more, grass-type fire calls over the years. We had a couple of windstorms that occurred that created some additional call volumes. We have more responses to sprinkler alarm and those kinds of calls that we're responding to. So motor vehicles, that was in there, motor vehicle collisions.
That was a big increase. That's right. Okay. So that includes the traffic. Traffic responses. Okay. Thank you. And then the last follow-up question was just on, I think, the second to last slide there. You had mentioned this, the transport and GEMT fees projected revenues of $2.2 million. Mm-hmm. I thought I heard you say that previously you had projected it'd be $1.1 million a year, but now you're projecting $2.2.
No, that's for 2 years.
Okay. Thank you.
The previous 15 and 16, I think it was projected at about $560,000.
Okay.
And we ended up at about $1 million a year.
Okay.
And we don't see that declining.
Okay, great. Thank you. I just wanted to clarify that. All right, thank you.
Councilmember Hurst.
Couple of quick questions. I noticed in talking about the survival rate for persons suffering out of hospital, cardiac arrests, we got 44.9%. What's the national standard for that?
I can't answer that. What I do know is that this, as I just read it today, that the South Snohomish area, this totality of this area, which runs about that same 49 to 51%, actually the fire district is about a 51%, has some of the highest national standard for survivability in the country. So this is, if you're going to have this kind of an event, this would be the place to have it. We sent enough resources to what we call a MedX, which would be a CPR call, that would be darn near the same as we send to a structure fire. I think we send 10 people to a MedX call. And that has really increased the survivability of that with the rapid CPR and all of the things that they do with that. So
it's 11%.
It is incredible here.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So in order to get an aid car out quicker than 2 years down the road, has there been any thought to peak hour deployment?
There is some thought. We don't know. Here's the rate. The deal with the fire department is that trying to get enough fire resources to the scene of a fire also has a number to it. So we still here in the city of Lynnwood have a 24-hour fire problem, and we only have a finite number of resources to send. When we go to a structure fire here in the city of Lynnwood, sending say 17 people, we usually can muster up about 8 to arrive on scene there. So at some point, if you're in your own fire department, what you should do is at least be able to meet the minimum response requirement for a single alarm fire, right? And so we haven't met that threshold yet with the number of firefighters we have on duty. Now, we could get away with potentially, you know, and that becomes, there's also labor issues with that and going with the peak hour, but through negotiations and that sort of thing. We may be able to get through a portion of time, and actually labor has had us, last year in 15, we actually did staff a 12-hour car for periods of time throughout the year. So labor has been working with us on that particular issue. At some point, we should, as a city, be able to provide enough resources to at least handle a single alarm fire 24 hours a day also.
Right, but since, what, 80% of the calls are EMS, I don't know where we get that balance, you know.
Right. Yep. The balance in my mind is that when you have enough resources to be able to meet a minimum response to a fire, then you can look at the balance. The difference after that becomes where you meet your EMS threshold. So at some point you should meet the 17 people on duty to be able to hit that structure fire, and then you meet your daytime peak hour activity to meet the rest of the demand that you might have for that 12-hour time frame. That's I can see the way you're looking at me. That is a way to deal with it.
Okay.
There are certainly challenges. There are challenges with that. But, you know, I think that, again, going back to, at some point, if you're going to have a fire department, you probably should be able to manage at least one fire with the resources that you have, right? So.
Anything else, Council? Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks for being last. The best to last. Is there any new business?
Move to adjourn.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Aye.